Hi, I'm Michael Correa, and this is Psych Exam Review. In this video, we're going to look at olfaction, or our sense of smell. So, how do we smell things? And what exactly is happening when you smell something? Well, the way that we smell things is that we use special cells, which are chemoreceptors, that interact with chemicals. And in the case of smell, we use olfactory receptor neurons. So these are neurons that are specialized for interacting with odorant molecules. So odorant molecules are molecules that float through the air off of the objects that we smell, and they go up our nose, and they interact with these receptor neurons. So we have about 10 million of these olfactory receptor neurons, and they come in different types. So we have about 350 different types of olfactory receptor neurons. So different molecules will stimulate different olfactory receptor neurons, and this allows us to smell different things. Now, of course, we can smell more than 350 different things because the things that we smell are complex. They're releasing, you know, a bunch of different molecules. And so the unique pattern of interactions that this group of molecules triggers will give us the unique sense that we experience. So let's look at a diagram of this. We can see that this flower here is releasing some pattern of molecules. And those are wafting up here, going up the nose, and they're going to interact with these olfactory receptor neurons. Now, it's kind of interesting to think about this, that when you smell something, you're really interacting with actual molecules from that thing. So this is fine when you think about a flower or you think about a freshly baked apple pie, right? That apple pie is releasing molecules out into the air. They're floating around in the room, and then they go up your nose and interact with your body. It's a little bit less pleasant when you realize that the same is true for bad smells. So if you walk into a bathroom and it smells really bad in there, you know, there's molecules of those things floating around in the air. They're actually going inside your body and interacting with some of your neurons. Let's go back to our flower example, a little more pleasant here. So this flower releases this unique pattern of molecules, and it reaches this olfactory epithelium. And here there's a layer of mucus, right? And this mucus sort of dissolves the molecules and allows them to interact with the olfactory receptor neurons. And then, depending on which olfactory receptor neurons are stimulated, they're going to stimulate these other cells called glomeruli. And this comes from the Latin for little balls of yarn. And that's because these are little tangled-looking cells here. And so a certain pattern of ORN activation will stimulate a certain group of these glomeruli, and these then send their messages from the olfactory bulb to an area of the brain where they're processed. Now, the area of the brain where this processing occurs is called the Rhinencephalon. And this literally means nose brain. So this is the area of the brain that processes this olfactory information. And it's kind of unique in that all of our other senses, the information first goes to the thalamus and then gets projected out to the cortex. But in the case of scent, we have this immediate connection between the olfactory bulb and the brain. And this area of the brain, the rhinencephalon, is linked to the limbic system. And this is responsible for emotion and memory. And this explains this connection we have between certain scents and emotions and memories. You've probably had the experience where a particular scent will sort of immediately remind you of something or immediately trigger some emotional response. And if we think about our evolutionary past, it makes sense to think that, you know, the scent of a predator, we might want that to immediately trigger a particular emotion. Now, it's possible to lose your sense of smell or to never have it in the first place, and this is called anosmia. And this can happen either because you're born this way, or you could have damage to your rhinencephalon, or you could have damage to your olfactory receptor neurons so that they don't function properly anymore. And this would prevent you from being able to smell. Now, other animals have an additional olfactory system, and this is called an auxiliary olfactory system. And this allows them to detect pheromones. So what are pheromones? Pheromones are chemical messengers that are sent between members of a species. right? So animals release pheromones, and then other members of their species can detect these pheromones, and this can influence their behavior. So often this is used in the context of mating. So animals will release particular pheromones, and this will influence their mating behavior of other members of their species. Humans, however, don't have a specialized auxiliary olfactory system. But we can detect pheromones, and humans do release pheromones, and they can have some influence on behavior. Now, one example of this is that humans are actually able to detect kinship based on pheromones. In other words, particular smells, you can tell who's related to you or not. Not exactly, you can't smell something and say, oh, this is definitely my long-lost brother, but that we can estimate some level of kinship based on smell. And this is happening essentially unconsciously, right, through these pheromones. Again, it's not this conscious process of this person smells like a second cousin and this person smells like an immediate family member or anything like that. But there's evidence that we can detect some degree of relatedness based on scent and based on pheromones. Okay, the last thing I want to mention is the relationship between scent and taste. Because in the next video, we're going to talk about taste. But you'll see it's very difficult to separate the two. Because when we smell food, you know, the foods that we eat are often releasing these odorant molecules, and those are interacting here. And then when we chew the food, you know, it's also able to go up sort of the back of the throat here and up here. And our sense of smell is going to be sort of intrinsically linked to our sense of taste. And so we'll see that in more detail in the next video. Okay, I hope you found this helpful. If so, please like the video and subscribe to the channel for more. Thanks for watching.